The question is, do you agree that Scotland should be an independent country?
For me, the principle that we work best when we work together, without coercion or conscription, bullying or bossiness.
Always whenever someone says, oh, a piece and sausage, and it's a roll and sausage, and it's sausage roll, we're better together.
Well, they didn't. It was us. We invented it, just like every other bloody thing.
Well, that's very interesting.
We have a very serious the referendum. It seems to me that they're not dealing with the issues.
Hi. If you've been fed up with most of the debate until now, the Scottish Independence Podcast is your chance to hear some different views on what the independence referendum means for Scotland. Hello, I'm Michael Greenwell, and this is the first Scottish Independence Podcast. We're going to try to do this every fortnight in the run-up to the independence referendum, but we may have some more frequent ones depending on what comes up. For this first one, I went down to Cambridge to speak to Donald Adamson, who's originally from Edinburgh but now teaches political economy at Cambridge and social science at the Open University. He writes for the Scottish Left Review and also, like me, for Bella Caledonia. In fact, there's going to be a part two to this podcast, but there'll be a couple of other ones in between, notably Andrew Tickle or Leland's Pete Worrier, who you may know him as, who will be on next time. So we should just go to the conversation and I'll have a wee word with you at the end. Okay, bye-bye. So I'm here with Donald Adamson in Cambridge University. He teaches political economy here at the university, and he also writes for Bella Caledonia and some other publications. Donald, it started in 1707. Do you think the Union's reaching the end of its trial period now?
I think it's already past that phase. One of the things I think that's interesting about what's been happening in the last three or four decades. I mean, I've been a supporter of independence since I can time it to the very year, 1973. And one of the things I think that's been happening in the last three or four decades, particularly in the Scottish left, is that there's been increasing disaffection with Britishness, particularly with the young democratic practices and institutions of the British state and British capitalism. But I think you have to appreciate also that there's a huge constituency in Scotland that's still very loyal to the British state and to the idea of Britishness.
Do you think that's a generational thing? Like, for example, in my family, everyone of my generation, basically almost everyone, is an independence supporter, whereas the kind of wartime generation are less independent supporting, but maybe the generations before the wartime there was more kind of independence and militancy in terms of independence.
Yeah, I mean, I think the post-war settlement and the settlement that was established by that first Attlee government in 1945, or the first two Attlee governments, 45 to 51, the second one only lasted about a year, was very important. I think it cemented ideas and concepts and institutions like the welfare state, which clearly are very important in Scotland. And I think the ideology of that clearly informs the Labour Party, Scottish Labour Party, who exercise a great deal of influence in Scottish politics and have done throughout the post-war period. But to get back to your earlier question about the trial of the Union, I think the Union is past its sell-by date, but there's an awful lot of reasons for that, and there's an awful lot of underlying explanations for that. My own interest, as I've already indicated, is in the fortunes of the Scottish left. And one of the things that I think needs to be kind of fully accommodated and fully understood by the left in Scotland is the growing importance of British economic imperialism. For example, when the Scottish left makes its critique of British imperialism, it understandably addresses issues like British military adventurism, British foreign policy, the wars and death and destruction that the British have waged and continue to wage on countries across the world, and of course British weapons of mass destruction. Those things are important, and of course they're critically important, and they're the most obvious manifestations of British imperialism. But I think underlying that is a British economic imperialism that needs to be more fully understood by the left. And there are a number of ways of looking at this. I mean, one of the ways that I like is to look at the balance of British investments and the balance between our British assets and liabilities in international investment. And one of the most notable things that's been happening since 1995, and this has been accelerating since 1997 when New Labour came into power, is that British liabilities, that is the capital that overseas holders hold in the City of London largely, has been larger than the assets that Britain holds, again channeled through the City of London and other countries in the world.
So there's a specific article about something related to that, but I was wondering what you thought about it. Have you read the famous article by Niall Aslan about the Great Deception?
Yeah.
And this extra regio country that they've created to funnel the money through?
Yeah.
Would you be able to talk about that a bit more?
Well, I have to say I'm much more interested, not that what Niall says isn't interesting, I'm much more interested in taking a more Marxist approach and much more influenced by the work of people like Robert Northfield at SOAS, the School of Oriental African Studies in London, and Kostas Lapavitsis, a Marxist economist. And one of the issues that they've raised is this issue about the net deficit in British investments. Because it equips and underpins Britain's ability to pursue this military adventurism, to deploy these weapons of mass destruction, to pursue its foreign policy. For example, in 2010, the value of British assets was, or British liabilities, was £250 billion larger than British assets. We also have to remember that every year since 1981, the British have been running a deficit in their visible trade balance. And I think one of the things the Scottish Left needs to ask is, how have the British managed this? How have they managed to pull this off, these twin deficits, for so long? Deficits that would have crippled most other national economies, with the obvious exception of the US. And the answer to that is that the British earn much higher returns from their assets than they do than they pay out in their liabilities held again in the City of London. And although it's true that some 80% of British assets are held in Europe and North America, where the returns are quite low, the real returns that the British earn from their assets in regions like Asia, Africa, the Middle East, and Latin America. And of course, the question is, why do the British do this? How does this increase Britain's earnings on or British capital's earnings on its net investments? And the answer is, there's a plentiful supply of cheap labour in these regions of the world that allows the British to earn more than double the return from the investments in these regions, Asia, Africa, the Middle East and Latin America, than they do in their assets from Europe and North America.
So it's an update of the exploitation project of the empire?
Basically, it's a second British empire. The first British empire obviously started to collapse in the 1950s and 1960s, in the decades after the Second World War.
And how would Scottish independence change that?
Well, this is something I do feel that the left does need to engage with. And actually, I think the Scottish left is engaging with this, because one of the great appeals of Scottish independence is that we'd allow Scotland to disengage from what is this second wave of British imperialism, British economic imperialism, which is based on the exploitation of the poorest workers in the world. Whether we like it or not, that makes us, as long as we're part of the British state, that makes us accomplices.
What do you think about the historical argument? Because very often if Scottish people complain about the British Empire in the past, you get kind of two points. One, a kind of fervent independence supporter would say, you know, well, we were the first colonised country, but a unionist would then turn around and say, well, yeah, well, the Scots have been complicit in all the crimes of the British Empire.
Yeah, I think the latter is an argument that Tom Devine quite rightly puts. But of course, what you have to remember as well, it was largely Scotland's ruling classes that, benefited from the empire. Mm-hmm. And whilst Scotland's ruling classes were benefiting from the empire, they were exploiting Scotland's workers in Scotland. The appalling conditions that the workers were working under in all kinds of industries and sectors of the economy. So yes, I think Tom Devine is right to make this point. It's a fair point, but now that we're aware, or now that we should be more aware of what the British are doing with this, with their British economic imperialism, there's no excuse anymore for for Scotland to not to disengage from this, its association with this, because it's this British economic imperialism that supports British military adventurism, British weapons of mass destruction, and its foreign policy. So I think the original point we'd hold is it's a substantive point, but again, I would look at this from a Marxist perspective, and the point I made earlier about, you know, it was largely Scotland's ruling classes that benefited from the empire, and again, it's largely Scotland's ruling classes that are benefiting from the second British Empire, from British economic imperialism. So yeah, that would be part of my form and part of my answer to that question.
Okay, and the idea with when I said at the start our trial period is partly as a joke, but partly not, because the part of the unionist response to this has been threats is the standard one, but there's also been lots of kind of promises of tinkering. You know, it's not the union that's broken, we just need to change this constitutional settlement a bit. So on the more constitutional side of it, what do you think is going on at the moment? What's in play?
Well, I think what's in play is the British are increasingly having, and the apologists of the British in Scotland are increasingly having to take defensive positions. Mm-hmm. And if you think about the pace of change in Scotland since 1999, it's been remarkable. We've not only seen kind of first generation devolution, we've seen Calman, and even before Calman is bedded in to the legislative process, even before it's properly operational, unionists are already talking about a new settlement. That's astonishing when you think that, you know, the Labour Party, the original Scottish Labour Party, had Home Rule as one of its foundational aims in the late 19th century. And we had to wait a whole century, over 100 years, for Labour to implement that. And yet in the space of little more than a decade, we've gone from first to second, now to third generation devolution. Mm-hmm. But I think there's a lot more at stake here, obviously. It's because I think one of the important issues that kind of strikes me, particularly from a lot of people who are either in the No campaign or have already expressed their intention to vote No in 2014, is that they seem to have kind of short-term time horizons. They seem to be afflicted with the British disease of short-termism. I mean, the British state and British capital has been in crisis for over 40 years now. Clearly it's in crisis now, but there's nothing new about crisis. Anyone who's read Marx or Keynes will be familiar with the notion of capitalism or the periodic crises of capitalism and why they occur. And I think this is to get back to the point where we kind of touched on earlier about the breakdown of the first British Empire in the decades after the Second World War. I think that created huge problems for the British, because you have to remember, the Empire gave the British huge privileges, access to cheap raw materials, cheap labour, the sterling area created a plentiful demand for dollars across the world. And of course, once the sterling area ended, and once the British Empire ended, and particularly once Bretton Woods collapsed in 1971, British capital, particularly British industrial capital, was fully exposed to international competition from capital overseas. Mm-hmm. And British capital was found wanting. Mm-hmm. And it's this deficit and this inability of the British, particularly industrial capital, to maintain the extraction of surplus value that it had previously extracted from workers in Britain, and of course the British Empire, that in many ways explains the earlier turn to neoliberalism and financialisation rather, in the of the British state. And I'd say this crisis really began in Britain in the late 1960s. And of course, every British government since the 1950s has tried to address this. The Tories tried to address it in the 1950s with corporatism, or quasi-corporatism, the peculiar variant of corporatism that the British tried to implement in the 50s and 60s. Wilson tried to reverse the fortunes of British industrial capital in the 1960s. He failed. Heath failed. The Heath government failed in the early 1970s. The Callaghan government failed. The Thatcher governments clearly failed. The Major government failed. The Blair governments failed. The Brown government failed. And of course, the current Cameron government is failing as well.
Sorry,
I was just going to say that this is one of the underlying reasons why the British have turned to financialisation.
So what alternative model could an independent Scotland follow?
Well, it's a very good question, and I think there are, again, a number of answers to it. There's no simple answer to it, but one of the things I think that independence would equip Scotland to do is to provide something that no British government has ever done or could do, and that's to develop a long-term strategy for the development of Scotland's economy. And of course there are numerous strands to this, but in order for Scotland to do that, it would need the powers and the steering mechanisms that only independence can provide. And if you think about it, the pattern of governance of Scotland, even with devolution, since the 1950s, is, you know, we've had a Tory government come into office for 10 or 15 years, introducing a wide range of reforms, market-oriented economic policies, welfare reforms, fiscal policies, changes to tax and benefit system. And then after 10 or 15 years of Tory government, a Labour government comes into office, usually for 5 or 6 years, and undoes all those policies and institutes its own reforms. And then after Labour's been in power for 5 or 6 years, Tories come into office again for another 10 or 15 years. They undo all the Labour Party reforms. It's short-termism, but I think the point we need to appreciate here is this has created a great deal of instability and uncertainty in Scotland. It's done a lot of damage to Scotland. And you can cite industrial policy, you can cite the welfare reforms, you can cite the inadequacies of migration policy. If you regress back to 2001, for example, although it's still more or less the case today, the vast majority of migrants to the UK settle in England. I think in 2001 there were around 500,000 migrants to the UK. Of those 500,000 migrants, 94% of them, 470,000 of them, settled in England. Mm. Less than 4%, 18,500, settled in Scotland, and the remaining 2.5% settled in Wales and Northern Ireland. And of course, one of the issues here is that the vast majority of UK migrants arrive at UK destinations in the south of England, in seaports and of course the big airports, particularly the London airports. But there's another issue here as well, of course, because historically UK migrants have settled in England, then UK migrant populations have been established in England, so new migrants to the UK want to join those communities. Mm-hmm. And for a migrant who's already travelled several thousand miles, arriving at a port in the south of England, the view to Scotland, another 500 or 600 miles up the road, is a pretty daunting prospect as well. Mm-hmm.
You've heard the idea that, you know, the Scottish society is more integrated than England. Now, living down here, do you think that's actually true?
Yeah, I mean, there are a number of kind of anecdotes I could kind of demonstrate that. I mean, I remember when I kind of lived in Edinburgh, we used to have. When I was a kid, we used to have what were called pooroots, where the bride and groom after the wedding would leave the church, and as he got into the car to go on their honeymoon, they would throw coppers out onto the pavement, poor out the money, in other words, and all the kids would scramble together to gather as much money as they could. We'd all kind of fight with each other for the money. Now, okay, that was a long time ago, so we need to be careful not to romanticise kind of contemporary Scotland in that from that perspective. But one of the things that struck me when I first moved down to England, to Cambridge, was I'd been living next to a next-door neighbour for about 9 months, and kind of knew them reasonably well, in the sense that we talked to each other briefly over the garden fence, and maybe, you know, if we met each other in the street or in town, we'd just, you know, exchange pleasantries. But in spite of the fact I'd been living with next to this couple for 9 months, I came out of my door one Saturday morning, and there was this huge limousine outside the door with these white ribbons on it. And as I was coming out, my next-door neighbour came out wearing a bridal gown. She was getting married. Mm-hmm. And I'd known her for 9 months, and I'd seen her for periods before that, immediately before that, but the first I knew that she was getting married was when I saw this car and saw her coming out of her house. And that would never have happened when I was a kid in Edinburgh, because weddings were very much communal. I mean, it's very different now, I appreciate that, but...
People tell their Facebook friends, not their neighbours now.
Well, yes, of course, technology is kind of as intruded there as in so many other areas of life, but...
I'm still not on Facebook and proud of it.
but I think the point is that I think it is fair to say, and surveys have demonstrated this, that there is less hostility to migrants in Scotland than there is in most parts of England, although I think most of the hostility to migration in England is in the southern half of England. It's quite interesting, for example, Ed Miliband made his famous immigration speech a few weeks ago from Peterborough, and one thing that wasn't picked up by the Scottish press, or the blogosphere for that matter, was the significance of Peterborough. I mean, I don't think Ed Miliband and his advisors chose Peterborough by getting a map of England out and sticking a pin in it. It was a very deliberate choice, because Peterborough, since 1971, has seen an increase of over 60% in its population. Its population now is 170,000, and of course the vast majority of that increase is accounted for by migration. Compare that to the relatively stagnant growth of Scotland's population in the same period. And why is that important? Well, many economists argue that migration adds somewhere between 0.5% to 1% to a country's GDP. But there's another more important reason, looking ahead to future decades, and that is that Scotland is facing a demographic time bomb. In the first half of the 21st century, we're going to have an increasing population of older people, largely economically inactive people, who are going to be more and more dependent on a smaller population of working age members of the population. And if Scotland doesn't have its own migration policy, then it's difficult to see how Scotland can avoid, ultimately, in the next 4 or 5 decades, declining into a backwater of the UK economy, because Scotland is unique, in fact, among, with the exception of countries like Wales and Northern Ireland, among smaller European economies, and hardly seen any change in its population over the last 50 years.
And there is a lot of space in Scotland.
There's a lot of space, and of course, it's obviously the case that one of the reasons there appears to be less hostility in Scotland to migrant communities than many communities in England, particularly in the south of England, is because Scotland has much less experience of migration than many communities in England.
So I think some in the Irish Catholic community would kind of disagree.
Yeah, like, but
it's still a fact that most just a point about Scotland rather than the general issue of the independence here, but it's still the case that most attacks on minorities in Scotland are against Irish Catholic.
Oh yeah, my grandfather came from Ireland, and my maternal uncle was in the mother's maternal uncle was in the original IRA. So I know what you're saying.
I've always felt that an independent settlement would help to solve these problems instead of exacerbate them. I don't know where you stand on that.
I mean, some people say there's a lot of wishful thinking in that, and I mean, I think it is true that the left in particular needs to be very careful about idealising independence. It's something that maybe many on the left are guilty of, but I think that's just a reflection of the aspirations that the left have for Scotland's future. And in fact, that returns back to a question you asked earlier about, you know, what's going on just now. How do we explain what's happening in Scotland just now? I mean, I think there are so many issues here, but migration is one area. The other area that I think does need to be picked up is the future of Scotland, and this issue, which I think is important, that many people in the No campaign and many people who intend to vote No in 2014 seem to be informed by these short-term time horizons. And they don't seem to be looking any further ahead than the next British election or the next British parliamentary term from 2015 onwards. And I think if we extend our horizons further than that, again, it's not just a question of idealising Scotland, which the left maybe has a propensity to do, because the kind of competitive radicalism of the left is never more intense than when capitalism is in crisis. And it's not difficult, you know, looking around the press, the left-oriented press and media, and of course the blogosphere, to encounter those. In fact, on that subject, and this is something that I think on the pages of Bella we've explored before, One of the things that interests me about Eric Olin Wright's Real Utopias project is that it does provide an agenda, possible agenda, for the Scottish left. And it might be better to maybe say a few words about what a real utopia is. And I mean, for most people, obviously, a utopia is an ideal society, usually future-oriented, although it can refer to a golden age in the past. And what Wright is effectively saying to the left is that rather than, because he's interested in developing pathways to socialism, mm-hmm. What Wright is effectively saying is that rather than idealise these utopias and look at these unreal utopias, why don't we look around us in the world today to see what real people in real communities are doing across the world? And he gives a number of examples in the book to illustrate what a real utopia is. He discusses participatory budgeting, basic income, cooperatives, Mondragon in Spain. And it's effectively what he's saying is, you know, here's the pathway that you can follow. Here's the beginning of the path. I can't tell you what your destination is, but why not start walking on this path and see where it takes you? And I like the kind of open-endedness of that. But there's a lot of things in Marxism in particular that Wright's thesis feeds into. For example, if you think about, I mean, as much as there is a unified Marxist theory of human nature, it's clear that in Marxist works themselves, he's communicating to us that there is a double-sidedness to human nature. For example, one side of our nature, then we can kind of identify as things like all people need to sleep, eat, drink, shelter. And whatever human society you're looking at whatever period of human history, that's the case. But there's also another side to human nature from a Marxist perspective, and that is that much of our human nature is determined by the mode of production, by the societies that we live in. And what those societies do is to naturalise relations of production. And now capitalism has unquestionably succeeded in this. You hear people every day saying that, you know, it's only natural for people to be competitive. It's only natural for people to want to make more money, and so on.
Or the misinterpretation of Darwin that's put onto capitalist society is another example of this.
Yeah, sort. Another variant of that, yeah. And of course, in a sense, they're right. What they're saying is right. But what they should say, what they should be taken to mean is that what modes of production do is naturalise certain means of certain relations of production, like competition, like making money, like marketisation, like the creation and expansion of value.
Whereas and just as easily, with time, cooperation could become the...
Yeah, I think this is in effect one way of reading what Wright is saying about real utopias, because it seems to me that the left has historically dismissed our capacity to construct alternative, to develop alternative relations of production to capitalism within capitalism itself. And I think this is really what Wright is trying to communicate to us. And of course, you know, no one is suggesting that this is easy, but the whole point about real utopias is it's saying that, you know, there is a transitory path to socialism. There is an alternative to traditional socialist conceptions of socialism. And he's thinking here, among other things, of the revolutionary leap to socialism. And I think if you look at Scotland today and other countries, advanced capitalist countries today, it's just not plausible to suggest that workers are on the verge of a socialist revolution. And I'm not sure how plausible it was even to imply, as many on the left historically have done, that, you know, we could go to bed at night living under capitalist relations of production and wake up in the morning living under socialist relations of production.
So what do you think, like, in all of the debate that's going on around independence at the moment, do you think the pro-independence left that aren't members of the SNP totally left out of the debate? It's only things like Bella and some of the bloggers that are picking up the slack on that, because there's so much of a debate going on that isn't in the mainstream, because the mainstream's putting it as it's the SNP or it's the union.
Yeah, I mean, I think you do get the sense from listening to the No campaign that the prize for them in 2014 is amounts to little more than the satisfaction of knowing that they've stuffed the SNP. And, you know, fair enough, that's politics, I suppose. But it's doing not only doing a huge disservice to the Yes campaign, I think in some ways it's doing a disservice to the SNP. like many people, I kind of have a kind of love-hate relationship with the. I mean, I wish the SNP was a different party to what it was. I wish it would take a more emphatic social democratic turn. I mean, I'm not a social democrat myself, obviously, but I'd certainly settle for an independent Scotland becoming a social a progressive social democracy in my lifetime.
Like you said earlier, piece by piece is better than waiting for the grand turn where everything comes at the same time.
I mean, if the revolutionary leap is going to happen, we'll be the first to know about it. So, you know, we don't need to wait about it. Obviously, the revolutionary left will continue to agitate for that, and rightly so.
Do you think Tory government in England brings independence sort of a step closer every time?
Yeah, I've felt that. I mean, one of the reasons that I kind of have supported independence for a long time is I have been convinced, I mean, even as a teenager back in the early 1970s, I have been convinced that Scotland really doesn't have a feasible future as part of the UK. And nothing that's happened in the last 40 years has persuaded me to change that opinion. And in fact, on the contrary, most of what's happened in the last 40 years has just reaffirmed that opinion, just underlined that opinion. And again, it's like we're discussing earlier about the failure of British governments and the impact of that failure on Scotland. It seems to me that one of the other possibilities of independence, notwithstanding the possibilities of democratic transformation of Scotland, is that independence could usher in a much-needed period of political stability to Scotland in terms of a Scottish government being equipped, but also Scottish society equipping itself to challenge elites, not just business and financial and political elites, but the cosy relationships of these elites with elites in the legal profession, the Scottish legal profession, Scottish media, and so on. And this democratic transformation, and the potential for this democratic transformation, seems to me to be much more possible in an independent Scotland than it could ever be under British rule.
Okay, so just to put on to the last thing, just change it to a more cultural level. So at the moment we've got the Jubilee, the Olympics, Wimbledon, and you're living down here in England. I'm kind of an interloper, I'm here occasionally, but you're down here at the moment, and I don't know if you're aware of the blogger, the Lalland Peat Warrior, who's actually quite funny.
Yes.
And he was talking, I think it was in Cambridge or maybe in Oxford, he was down at a meeting with various dons all around, and he brought the subject of Scottish independence came up, and someone at the table said, "Oh, silly little notion." You know, something like
this.
And I don't know, how do you find it here when the subject comes up with other, you know, with other academics? And
well, it's funny you say that. I mean, you're talking about the Olympics and Jubilee and so on. In a couple of hours' time, the torch will actually be arriving in Cambridge.
Which I'll be ignoring.
and me too, Michael. And me too. And I suspect most people in Cambridge will as well. I think there has been this kind of traditionally this dismissive attitude to independence. But I think what the constituency that are called unionists, obviously that's a shorthand term, are having to come to terms with now that independence and the movement for independence is here to stay. Again, I can remember the dark days after the second 1974 general election and into the 1980s, when in many ways living in Scotland was kind of almost like living in exile in your own country. Again, this was our experience with Scottish education.
For example, one of my friends was a young boy. I remember if he came into the class and he said, "I've got a Saer Hyd," and he was ritually punished.
Yes.
Like, not ritually punished. Like, humiliated in front of the class for about 15 minutes for saying it in a perfectly acceptable way. Yeah. I think it's a bit different now, but I couldn't really...
Oh, I think it's different now, yeah. I mean, I've got relatives who've gone through primary and secondary school in Scotland in the last 10 years, and it is different. I don't think it's radically different, but it is different. But I think, like most people of my generation, we started to learn about Scottish history after we left school. It was as if kind of Scottish history was a taboo subject. We learned about Mary Queen of Scots, and
we did. I'm from a different generation to you, and we did basically Bannockburn happened, and then nothing happened at all until the Industrial Revolution.
Yeah,
and then it was the First World War, and that was it.
Yeah, yeah.
The whole settlement, the Act of Union, didn't get a look. Not a word.
Yes. And there was no prospect whatsoever of names like James Connolly, Thomas Muir, or John McLean ever that would have been heresy in a Scottish classroom. Probably still that probably still is the case today as well. But I think to get back to your question about how dismissive many people, particularly from a British perspective, who see themselves as British, whatever their nationality is, they have obviously, as we said, been traditionally dismissive of independence. But it would be wrong, I think, to see the movement for independence as an expression just of nationalism.
Yes, that's what I was getting to. What's the cultural element of it, do you think?
Well, I think part of the cultural element is it's a reaction. A lot of it is a response to British nationalism and to the impact that British nationalism has had on Scotland. We spoke earlier about the two British empires, the original and the new British economic empire. I think one of the things that kind of is interesting here in thinking about Scotland's future is that in thinking in terms of the independence movement as being a reaction to Britishness, it's precisely the policies of British governments, but also I think the increasing perception among many people in Scotland, particularly on the left, but not just on the left, the collective self-determination as expressed in the creation of an independent Scottish nation-state could be a means of advancing more meaningful self-determination for individuals and communities in Scotland.
Okay. I think that's a very good point to leave it.
Oh, okay, Michael, excellent. That was great. well, I thought it was okay. Yeah.
Thanks, Donald. Hello again. So that's the end of the first part with Donald Adamson. The second part will be coming up in a couple of weeks. There'll be another podcast with Lallan's Peat Warrior between now and then. Just a couple of little announcements to make. First, thanks to Bella Caledonia for hosting this on their SoundCloud page. You'll be able to find the rest of these there. Obviously, this is the first one of these podcasts, so if you've got any suggestions or you would like to get involved, please leave something in the comments on Bella Caledonia or email me. If you think there's someone we should speak to, if you think there's a subject we should address, let us know. To finish this first episode, I probably should finish up with a song, so I'll do this one, which I think, given what he was on about, Donald Adamson might quite like. Matt McGinn with the Ballad of John McLean.